Today what we are going to show you will be the results of the research that was done over some period of time, but more specifically over the last few months by the MAPA digital fellow here at the Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute, Nataliia Levchuk. And I say a few words about Nataliia and the manager of the MAPA project, Kostyantyn Bondarenko. And this is the research dealing with the module of MAPA project, which has been the most developed one, the first where the MAPA, the Digital Atlas of Ukraine, started. So the module dealing with the Holodomor, or Great Ukrainian Famine of 1932-1933. We developed that project and then went into researching other subjects, including Kievan Rus, including the medieval Podilia, and recently in the last year, year and a half, we're paying a lot of attention to contemporary Ukraine. Module with different sub-modules, or specific projects within it, dealing with attitudes to language, for example, with the Leninopad, or the demolition of monuments to Lenin, and the dramatic change in the map of memory in contemporary Ukraine. But again, this year, and in particular this last semester, we had a chance, thanks to the presence of Nataliia, to go back to our old project, the first one, our flagship, and first of all revise some data, but also do new research, and in particular research dealing with the demographics and data on the victims of famine on the raion level, something that we were not being able to do back then. And we also went outside of the borders of Ukraine and did some research on Russia and different regions of Russia as it compares to Ukraine. I don't know whether we will have a chance to get into that, but that was another main focus of what we were doing this semester. And now, before asking Nataliia and Kostyantyn to make their presentation, I will say a few words about both of them. So Nataliia Levchuk is a senior, I understand, senior research fellow, would be the right translation, or?
It's okay.
So senior research fellow at the Ptucha Institute of Demography and Social Studies at the National Academy of Sciences of Ukraine. She is a graduate of the Taras Shevchenko National University in Kyiv. Her candidate dissertation in demography comes from the Institute of Economics of the National Academy of Sciences of Ukraine. And his doctoral or habilitation degree comes from the Institute of Demography and Social Studies, where she works now. Nataliia is author of quite a few publications. The list is quite long. The CV is 6 pages, so you probably don't expect me to read all of that. So I will mention only the latest publications out of the list of selected papers and book chapters. So together with Oleg Volovina, Omelian Rudnitsky, and 2 other co-authors, Nataliia wrote a paper on regional variations of 1932-1934 famine losses in Ukraine, which was published in Canadian Studies in Population in 2016. With a number of other co-authors, she also wrote another paper, Famine Losses with the, Within the Context of the Soviet Union, which was published in the collection entitled Famines in European Economic History, published by Routledge in 2015. And Kostyantyn Bondarenko is the project manager of MAPA, Digital Atlas of Ukraine, something that I already mentioned to you. And he got his education in Ukraine, Bachelor of Arts at the what used to be Kirovohrad State Pedagogical University, now it's Kropivnitsky State Pedagogical University in Ukraine, and was also taking courses in international business and information technology at Webster University in Geneva and Harvard Extension School here. And Kostyantyn is really IT power behind all of our projects. So if there is something right with them, and there is a lot of things that are right, Kostyantyn is the person to be thanked for that. And if there is anything wrong with them, then probably I, as the scientific director of the entire enterprise, should be blamed for that. So with this, I hope it was relatively short introduction. I will pass the floor to Nataliia and Kostyantyn.
So I'll start quickly. I just want to make a very short progress report of what we've done, and I'll just show you on the additions that we made to the website before Nataliia will present her research findings. Her findings are based on the new maps that we have created during this time, and all the maps that you will see in her presentation are available on the website for download and also in the interactive atlas. So just a quickly to refresh your memory that how to get to the website, you can get there from our main website, from the HURI website. You go to projects and then go to MAPA. So, and this is, we're already in the main website, so this is the main page. And again, to get to, as you can see, we have different sub modules here, and the Great Famine of Ukraine module is under the Historic Atlas. And if you click here, you'll have a full page opens that will open here with more information about that module. So we have added a number of static maps. I'll start with that. And those you can find under the Famine Galleries. Okay, so click here and here. So these are just images. These are the regular images that you can just download. There's not much else you can do. You can download, insert them, as long as you use the copyright notice. So if we go to the thematic maps, these are the four subcategories. One of them, the famines of 1920s, we have not added any maps, but the other three, we have added new maps to all of them. And all in all, if you look at them, we have 63 images here. In the interactive atlas, we have twice as many. And the interactive atlas also has an advantage that not only do you have more maps there, but you also can combine different maps and you can create a lot more maps than originally are predefined there. So in the demographic, we Nataliia brought new data. We adjusted some numbers. So the maps that you have here already have some adjusted numbers, and we redid some of them. The graphically also look a little bit different from what it used to be. For those of you who follow MAPA, this may not be new, but some people may think that we still have the same stuff, but we really basically doubled the amount of maps. Actually, in the interactive atlas, we tripled the amount of maps that we have right now. Okay, so we'll go back here to the to this section. There is only one new map here, but this map is interesting because here we have now the raion level map here. The increase in the amount of maps comes from different factors, and one of them is that most of the new maps now they have data on the raion level, which, as you understand, of course, allows you to make better analysis, gives you a more nuanced picture of what you're researching now. In the government policy category, we have three subcategories, and most of the new maps were added into collectivization and procurement. Procurement used to have only, see this top level maps on the oblast level, but now we have added new maps here on the raion level. So in the procurement, we actually have more than doubled the amount of maps. And I'll go quickly now, jump quickly to the interactive atlas. Interactive atlas now has all in all 121 maps, used to be about 50. So we have a lot more of them. And also, most of the maps that we have added now have raion level data. So I'll go back. So this is the, as you have, you can see the categories kind of the same that you have seen in the galleries. They're a little bit different in the galleries. So we put them, more of them in the same category here. They're divided into smaller categories. So under population losses, I'm not going to give a lot of talk here about the interface. We already had previously another presentation where I was talking about the how to use MAPA, so I'm just going to be using it. But if you have questions along the way, feel free to ask me. So when you open this tab here, all the layers then open down, and as you can see, they're all disabled. And the way it goes right now, that on top we have the oblast level maps, and then when we start going down, you come to the raion level maps. And another feature that is new now to this, that before we all only had choropleth maps, which is a map like this, where you have polygons colored with different shades representing different values. And that is great when you just have one map open, but it was always an issue, how do you compare more than one map? We have a swipe tool that you can actually swipe through the maps, but it doesn't really work that well. So what we have done here, we added a number of maps with diagrams, with charts. And that allows you now to overlay chart maps with bars or circles over these choropleth maps and combine now two variables, and in some cases more, because chart maps, I'll show you later, actually allow you to map more than one value at a time, as opposed to choropleth or thematic maps that only allow you to map one value here. You can only do one value here because this is just shades of the same color. So we'll go quickly through one of the charts I'll show you. So this is a chart, for instance, this is the same map of the total direct famine losses per 1,000, but now is a chart. So now if you want to, for instance, compare this to a map, let's pick something from procurement and grain loans, right? And if we say, for instance, these are losses in 1933, let's look at the actual grain procurement in 1932-33. And you click here, there's the legend for both maps, and now you can start doing your spatial analysis. Just visually, you can see if there is a correlation between the number of death and the procurement and grain loans here, and grain procurement. These are absolute numbers, but you can also pick per 1,000. These are ratios here as well. And you can see here we have both of these legends open. So as you can see, with the combination of choropleth and thematic, you can actually create your own map. Another addition that we made to the second category of population losses is for the first time we have data now for Russia, not just Ukraine. And I'll show you quickly. We have several of these maps here. Okay, so the first one, so this is, you can see on the European part of Ukraine, but when you zoom out, I'm sorry, of Russia, but when you zoom out, you can see more of the Russian regions and goes all the way, although the data doesn't really change there. You probably would be more interested in the European part. That's why by default it opens right here. So that's a big change. Another big change that you will notice here also is that the data that so far we always mapped them on the historical borders, on the historical borders of Ukraine as of 1932-33. This for the first time Natalia brought data that was recalculated and we were able to map it on the contemporary borders of Ukraine. And this, I'll show you some of these maps too. For instance, this is rural direct losses as now this is, as you can see, the borders, actual contemporary borders, these are contemporary oblasts, and you can click on them and see. And this is one of the things that we found out, that many times before we referred to losses mainly in Kiev and Kharkiv, but now if you start looking at the contemporary borders, they're mostly, the losses actually would be Cherkasy, Kiev, and Poltava, because these are the new oblasts. If you, you know, you have, you, they had to recalculate that, and so the results are a little different. And last thing I want to tell you, so in addition to new maps, to the amount of new maps, I have also added a few more tools here. Again, maybe you remember I talked about some of these tools, and for instance, if we take the filter tool, I added more filters here, and I also added a new tool where you can create your own filter. This is more complicated, I'm not going to go into that too much, but if we have time, I can show you some of this, how this works. I'll just pass the food.
Thank you so much for inviting me to speak today. I'm going to talk about regional variations of Holodomor losses at the raion level, which is the smallest administrative unit in Ukraine. And let me start by giving you some background information. This project is based on our previous works on the demography of Soviet famine in 1932-33. Our demographic team estimated first population losses for 11 Soviet republics, then for Ukraine total and by region, and by urban and rural areas, and then recently comparative analysis of demographic losses between and within Ukraine and Russia. All this work has been done in collaboration with Ukrainian Research Institute, in particular the MAPA project. First, I would like to remind you the definition of famine losses. So there are direct and indirect losses. Direct losses or excess deaths are calculated as the difference between all deaths during the famine years and so-called expected normal deaths, assuming there had been no famine. And indirect losses or lost births are the difference between the expected normal births, assuming there was no famine, and actual numbers of births. So we estimated famine losses in terms of excess deaths for Ukraine in 1932-34 at 3.9 million, and indirect losses or lost births at 600,000 lost births, total 4.5. In our previous work, we found profound regional differences in the losses from starvation among large regions of Ukraine or oblasts. So the eight regions that existed at that time, Kyiv, Vinnytsia, Kharkiv, Chernihiv, Donetsk, Dnipropetrovsk, Odessa, and Moldova and Moldavian Republic as a part of Ukraine at that time. So these eight regions correspond to 17 contemporary oblasts of Ukraine. And contrary to our expectations, as you see, the highest excess deaths due to the famine are not found in the southern grain-producing Odessa and Dnipropetrovsk oblast, but in the north-central Kyiv and Kharkiv oblast. In addition, our recent research has shown that, first, relative excess, relative excess deaths in Ukraine on average are 4 times higher than for Russia. And second, there is no correspondence between the pattern of geographical distribution of excess deaths in Ukraine and Russia. The most affected Kyiv and Kharkiv oblasts in Ukraine didn't play traditionally like main or like significant major role in grain production, while in the Russian Federation, the main grain producing region suffered the most. Volga German Republic, Saratov Oblast, and Krasnodar Krai. But today, let's move onto our topic. I'm going to focus on excess deaths in rural areas of Ukraine only in 1933, so 3.3 million. The goal of this study is twofold. First, to estimate the direct 1933 rural population losses and explain in terms of excess deaths across raions of Ukraine. And second, to define the possible determinants of regional differences in the Holodomor losses. So our primary research question is what factors might have contributed to regional variations of losses. Two hypotheses are considered. The first one is that the regional differences are explained by the grain procurements, and the second one that the regional differences in the famine-induced mortality are explained by the level of collectivization. Where do our data come from? Let me first give you an overview about the main sources of death statistics. There are two kinds of sources, individual and aggregate. So individual death certificate contain very important information, and I would like to show you just some example of death certificate for 1933 found in the Kharkiv State Archive. Kharkiv Oblast, Valkivsky Rayon, excess deaths 133 per 1,000 of population, death registration book. So as you see here, it's a 5-year-old boy, Ukrainian. Cause of death is specified here. So with slabosti ta голоду, from weakness and hunger, yeah. And his father was independent farmer who abandoned his children. The next one is 33-year-old man, Ukrainian, again died from hunger at home. It's here, Holod. Worked for independent farmer. The next one, 21-year-old man, Ukrainian. He worked for collective farm, and again, cause of death from hunger at home. But the problem with such documents is that these certificates are not preserved for most regions of Ukraine. And for instance, Ukrainian historian Gennady Borok found an order issued in 1934, so after the famine, 1 year after 1933, order to remove death registration books for 1933 from Silrada village councils and transfer them to so-called rayon vykonkom or oblvykonkom, so rayon executive committees for safekeeping as classified material. So most of these books are not preserved, and if they preserve, they are not digitized. And there is another source, data source, aggregate statistics, which we used. So our estimation of losses is based on data from central archives in both Kyiv and Kharkiv. And I show just example how this looks like. This is statistical form, deaths by age and sex, and urban and rural areas for Ukraine. And here I have deaths by age, not by age, but by rayon for Kyiv region. So we used these statistics. We collected data on population and vital statistics for 1925 to 1930 by rayon, including 1926 census, also plus the year of 1933, and information about changes in administrative structure of Ukraine during that period. Methodology. So I will skip all technical steps of our estimating process, but just call your attention to the main stages. So In the first stage, we reconstructed this annual data for the pre-famine period and also for 1933. Then we recalculated this data from the structure, from the raion structure of in 1926 to the raion structure in 1933. Then made adjustment of undercount in 1933, estimated deaths that would have occurred without the famine, and finally estimated the number of excess deaths in 1933 for 391 raion as of April of 1933. And you already have seen this map, and I would like again to show you. As you see, there is no clear north, south, or west, east gradient in the special distribution of the direct losses across Ukraine, across rayons of Ukraine. And the highest excess deaths are mostly found in the forest steppe rayons of central Ukraine, Kyiv and Kharkiv Oblast. The range of losses is quite huge, 1 to 540 per 1,000 of rural population. And we have two maximum in Hlobinsky rayon of Kharkiv region, 540, and Titiivsky rayon of Kyiv. So it's approximately Titiivsky rayon and Hlobinsky rayon. We can say that like 54% of rural population in Hlobino and 52% of rural population in Titiiv rayon perished from the famine in these rayons. So definitely this map shows us that something unique was happening in Kyiv and Kharkiv region. And now I will move on to next part of my presentation, exploring these regional variations in losses and identifying possible factors responsible for these distributions. So I collected data from published statistics, statistical guidebooks of 1920s, 1930s, and this table lists some of them. All these indicators, like most of them, are relative, so they are standardized by rural population. As you see, basic information about rural population, like rural population density, percentage of Ukrainians, then level of collectivization as of October, December 1932, number of collective farms per 100,000 population, distance from rayon center to the nearest railway station, blackboard index indicating if this rayon had at least one blackboard entity like blackboard village or collective farm or rayon. Then the percentage of land used for wheat, structure of wheat sown areas by independent farmers, collective farms, state farms, also all crop sown area by independent farmers and collective farms. We also managed to collect a rich data set on procurement quotas in 1930 to 1932 in terms of planned quotas, actual procurement, and fulfillment of planned procurement. Fulfillment means planned divided by actual in percent. Most of this data come from the statistical guidebook, so 8 volumes arranged by region, and additionally these two books, which I used. So we represented all these statistics by creating a series of maps that are integrated into MAPA project already, and I'll show some of them. So in red, our map of losses, ethnic composition, percentage of Ukrainians, in yellow, then rural population density in green, and percentage of sown area used for wheat in yellow-brown color. So as you see, there are some similarities, I would say, between the distribution of excess deaths and rural population density. Also, this might be a spurious correlation, implying that it was just easier to search for grain in like densely populated areas compared to sparsely populated areas. Also, it raises a question of transport possibilities. There is also a link between excess deaths and ethnic composition. And as you see, percent of sown wheat area and excess deaths, they don't follow in the same way, I would say, the distribution. To sum up briefly, what can be derived from these maps is that the rayons with the highest excess deaths, located in Kyiv and Kharkiv oblasts, were more likely to be densely populated and had higher percentage of Ukrainians and lower percent of sown wheat area in Kyiv and Kharkiv compared to Odessa and Dnipropetrovsk. And now let's turn our attention to another factor, procurement. It turned out that the dynamics of procurement quotas was very complex during the 1930-1932. And first, I provide you some summary for Ukraine at the national level. The harvest in 1933 was very successful, probably due to early and warm spring. And the plan was fulfilled. Then the plan for the next 1931 year was foresaw a further increase, but on average for Ukraine by 9%. And this plan wasn't fulfilled, 91% almost, but still not fulfilled. It is worth mentioning here that in 1932, plan was reduced, and compared to 1930 and 1931, it was revised three times. And the final plan was reduced by 35%. But I would add important remark that the final reduction was approved approximately January 1933, so too late, the end of procurement campaign. The actual procurement in 1932 was lower by 45% compared to the previous year. So this is a general picture showing some increase in quotas for 1931 and decrease in quotas for 1932. Then looking at this slide, we can come up with another explanation for a very good harvest in 1930, an increase in the sown area, and a shift in the structure of sown area resulted in the rise of land used for wheat. But in 1931, as I mentioned, the rise in quota was by 9%, but the increase in the sown area was just only by 3%. And in 1932, there was reduction of both plan and sown area. All these changes refer to Ukraine total at the national level. And now I would like to expand on my point about the complex dynamics of procurement quotas and show you how this change occurred at the regional level, because they were not uniform across rayons. So on the map on the left, on this map, you can see that the majority of rayons in red, Vinnytsia, Kyiv, Kharkiv, they experienced significant increase in their planned quotas in 1931 compared to 1930, while the majority of rayons in Odessa and partly in Dnipropetrovsk, that are prime grain-growing regions of Ukraine, they experienced respective decreases.
This is grain in all the regions. This is just for grain?
This is grain procurement quota. I'm talking only about grain procurement quota. Yes. So by contrast, on the map on the left, you can observe almost a reversal situation. So increased quotas for Odessa, partly for Dnipropetrovsk in 1932 compared to 1931, to previous years, and decreased quotas for Kyiv, Kharkiv, and Vinnytsia. The regional distributions of the fulfillment of these quotas in 1930 and 1932 again didn't follow the same way. In 1930, the majority of the country, the majority of the rayons, Vinnytsia, Kyiv, Kharkiv, Chernihiv, and even part of Odessa, fulfilled, so attained their plans, except for some rayons of Odessa and Dnipropetrovsk, which are in blue. Odessa, Dnipropetrovsk in red. So while in 1932, only Vinnytsia and Kyiv managed to attain their plans. So how can we sum up briefly these changes in procurement quotas at rayon level? So a good harvest in 1930, then an over-fulfillment in Kyiv, Kharkiv, Chernihiv, many rayons of Vinnytsia. Then in 1931, a large increase in grain quotas for mostly non-main grain-growing, grain-producing areas of Vinnytsia, Kyiv, and Kharkiv, and a decrease in quotas for grain-producing Odessa and partly for Dnipropetrovsk. This is important because Kharkiv Oblast had the largest increase in 1931 quotas. And in absolute terms, this non-grain producing oblast but managed to yield larger quantities of grain than Odessa. In other words, Kharkiv made up the grain that Odessa should have produced in 1931. We also found a strong correlation, positive correlation, between excess deaths and plant, both plant and actual procurements for Kyiv Oblast. The higher the quota, the higher the population losses across rayon within Kyiv Oblast. Positive correlation between excess deaths and percentage of wheat sown area. So the higher the percentage of land used for wheat in Kyiv Oblast, within Kyiv Oblast, the higher the losses. Surprisingly, there are no such correlation. There is no correlation for Kharkiv Oblast. But what we found is a negative relationship between the increase in 1931 plant quotas and percentage of wheat sown area. The smaller was the percentage of land used for wheat, the higher the increase in 1931 plant quotas. And this also works for Kyiv Oblast. Overall, that means that in 1931, Kyiv and Kharkiv, especially Kharkiv, were imposed with much larger quotas than in previous year. And second, that these quotas were distributed disproportionately to the geography of sown wheat area. And this resulted in an absolute shortage of food by the end of 1931 in these rayons, an early start of the famine in 1932. Although these rayons did receive large reduction next year, in 1932, it seems that they didn't recover. This raises an obvious question. Why? Why Odessa did receive so large discount, and why Kyiv and Kharkiv were overloaded by procurement quotas in 1931? Many possible factors, like there might be different factors. One of the explanations, like, immediately comes, but we need to test it, weather shock. So I recently got data for 385 rayons, monthly rayon-level temperature and precipitation data from January 1931 to December of 1932. But to understand the dynamics of this data, so we use not like absolute data, but difference between temperature rainfall during given months by rayon and the pre-famine average temperature or rainfall. Pre-famine means from 1926 to 1930 by months and by rayon in percent. So I have this data by rayon. So this is a deviation from normal local conditions in the pre-famine period and 1931, like by months 1931 and 1932. But I would like to show you like brief summary by oblast. I understand that these like numbers differ across within each oblast, but my aim is just to like provide brief summary of these changes. So I identified weather shock in April of 1931, very cold April of 1931. Then early frost in November of 1931, and very cold February of 1932. And then two like intensive rainfall in April of 1932 and June of 1932. So my first point is that I don't see any extremely high temperature in summer, either of 1931 or 1932. So I cannot identify any like drought across the whole, like across all oblasts of Ukraine. I like edit July of 1931 and 32 just to show you that there were no large deviations from normal local conditions. But my second point is that there was unusually cold weather in April of 1931 that might have affected crop yields, but I don't see extreme differences between Kharkiv and Odessa. That's why I argue that temperature shock in April of 1931, unfavorable like weather conditions in 1931, as an explanation for substantial reduction in 1931 quotas for Odessa is likely not to be confirmed. There is also positive correlation between temperature shock in April of 1931 and an increase in quotas in Kharkiv and in Kyiv Oblast. That means that these upgraded, enhanced quotas in these regions were imposed without taking into account possible effects of cold spell in 1931, in spring of 1931. So what about 1932? I don't know yet. It needs to be tested. But to my knowledge, like from previous research, there is no evidence about substantial crop failure in 1932. And now let me turn to another factor, collectivization factor. So to your left, a map of collectivization for 1930 produced by Nataliia Nauminko, which looks differently from what we have in our map of collectivization as of December of 1932 on your right. As you see, there was probably a shift in the collectivization rate from the central zone in 1930 to the south, yeah, in 1932. Additionally, the map on the left does seem to correlate with our losses map, while the map on the right does not. Different factors might have triggered these changes in the regional pattern of collectivization. As we know, after the publication of Stalin's article, DZV's success, on, I think, March 2nd, 1930, there started massive exodus of peasants from collective farms. And Nauminko, following Witkoff's suggestion, stated in her research that in the south of Ukraine, peasants were less likely to leave the collective farms due to two reasons. They needed to get some land allotment from collective farms before they leave. But because the early and warm spring of 1931 and early start of sowing campaign, they didn't have time to leave the collective farms. So in areas where springs came earlier, the impact of Stalin's article was smaller, increasing the collectivization rate in the south of Ukraine. But in my opinion, the effect of Stalin's article, Stalin's publication, could have resulted into more massive exodus peasants from collective farms in Vinnytsia, Kyiv, in Kharkiv, not just because spring came later compared to the south, but because of peasants' unwillingness and opposition to the Soviet regime and collectivization in these rayons. There is some evidence that the highest rate of peasants' protest activity in Ukraine in 1930 was observed exactly in Vinnytsia and Kyiv. So my question is, are there any link between the decreased collectivization in 1930 and increased procurement quotas in 1931 in the same rayons of Vinnytsia, Kyiv, and Kharkiv? Were these rayons targeted by over procurement in 1931 because of their massive exodus from collective farms? So this is a question for future research. Our analysis shows that in Kyiv, Vinnytsia, Chernihiv, we found positive and statistically significant correlation between the rate of collectivization and excess deaths. while in Odessa and Donetsk there is a negative correlation. The same relationship exists when we compare the structure of zone areas by collective farms and independent farmers. On the one hand, and excess death. So that means that the higher percentage of crops area for collective farms, the higher losses. That means that there was more pressure on collective farms in less collectivized rayons of Kyiv, Kharkiv, Chernihiv, Vinnytsia, and on independent farmers in more collectivized rayons of Odessa. Nevertheless, the assertion that the scale of losses was determined exclusively by grain procurement or exclusively by level of collectivization, in my opinion, cannot be proven. Why? Because itself it couldn't have led to such like massive and so serious famine that followed in 1933. As we know from archival documents, in order to suppress the peasant resistance to collectivization and procurement, in Ukraine was implemented large-scale like system of repressive measures. And I list here some of them. Requisition of, in addition to regular grain procurement, there was requisition of grain seed set aside for the next harvest. There was also requisition of grain emergency reserves, which I didn't found for any Russian regions. Confiscation of grain paid to collective farmers for work previously performed. Fines in kind, meat and potato, so-called встречные планы, I don't know how to translate, additional quotas. That means that collective farms that already fulfilled their plans were targeted by additional quotas to make up quotas for those collective farms that didn't fulfill. Then blackboard system, blockade of borders and restriction or peasant movement. And finally, confiscation of all foods. We have thousands of Holodomor testimonies of survivors that not just grain, but all foods was taken away. Collection of data on repressions, like by oblast, actually these data are very fragmentary and incomplete. I just show you some of them. I collected, but I understand that it's not complete. So here you can see fines in kind. All these indicators are standardized by population, so these are relative indicators, which make it comparable. So fines in kind, the highest rate. Kharkivska, Odesska, Dnipropetrovska. Number of brigades requisition grain. Kharkivska, Kyivska, and Vinnytska. And number of persons arrested for sabotage and resistance to grain procurement. Kharkivska, Odesska, and Dnipropetrovska. But like to collect such data by rayon, it will take a lot of efforts and time. And I don't know if it's possible. So my preliminary conclusions, because this analysis is not yet complete, it's just work in progress. The highest excess deaths are mainly found in the central forest steppe rayons of Kyiv and Kharkiv. The origins of the regional distribution of excess deaths, in my opinion, started much earlier than in 1933, and the period of 1930-32 is very important for understanding what was happening next in 1933. There is a strong and statistically significant correlation of excess deaths in Kyiv Oblast with grain procurement quotas. In 1931, the government didn't intend to collect more grain from the most productive Odessa region, but targeted the less productive Kharkiv, Kyiv, and Vinnytsia. The distribution of the increased 1931 plan in Kharkiv and Kyiv Oblast by rayon was very uneven and unjustified because it was done disproportionately to their potential grain capacity and ignored the possible adverse consequences of weather shock in these regions. And this resulted in absolute shortage of food by the end of 1931 and early start of the famine in 1932 in these rayons. Even though they received large reduction of their plans in 1932, it seems that it didn't help. There was more procurement pressure on collective farms in less collectivized rayons of Kyiv, Vinnytsia, and Kharkiv, and on independent farmers in more collectivized rayons of Odessa Oblast. Presumably, there was very complex interaction between the changes in procurement quotas and the level of collectivization that might have contributed to the intensity of the famine. Nevertheless, the statement about that the scale of losses was determined exclusively by procurement, I think it's not confirmed, because the increase in 1931 quotas itself and the reductions of plan in 1932 couldn't have led to such serious famine that followed in 1933. That's why I think that we should distinguish between the famine resulted from grain procurement and the famine resulted from grain procurement coupled with massive repression and a total non-grain food requisition. But still, different factors need to be further explored. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Nataliia. For someone who has been involved in research and in research on the famine, I want to say that there is just astonishing amount of new data that has been added to the plate of those who are interested in that subject, and also a lot of it was mapped that allows us to look at that and understand maybe better what is going on. But as it happens again and again in the MAPA project, the further you move forward, the more questions are there. Of course, there is more food for thought, but there are also more questions. So again, I want to thank Nataliia for this presentation, and Nataliia and Kostya for working together on visualization of that. But again, there is a significant group of people working behind that, Oleg Volovina and Nataliia Levchuk's colleagues at the Institute of Demography. So without their work, that research and those results would not be able, would be difficult to get and then present to you. So with that, I am opening floor for questions and comments.
Yes. Thank you, first of all, for this extraordinary work. My question has to do with geography. So you mentioned you didn't find a significant distribution north-south or east-west, but just looking kind of an untrained eye on the map, you saw that it was the edges of Ukrainian territory, whether they border Russia or Poland, seem to be affected less than those that are closer to the center, right? The on the raion level. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering how you explain that.
And I wonder if it's would be possible maybe to get back to that map and.
Do you mean like excess deaths? Yeah,
yeah,
our base
the
map.
The fundamental problem.
Yeah. Oh, sorry, maybe. No, as you see, like high concentration of excess deaths in central, I would say, zone of Ukraine. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And less. And lower excess deaths on the border, I mean western border, like I cannot explain exactly for this part, but as I know, there is like border hypothesis, that states that exactly in these rayons, Soviet regime implemented like measures were more less severe than in, for instance, in Kyiv and Kharkiv Oblast, just because maybe they're afraid that the like border regions.
But this also seems to be true on internal borders, right? Like up north of Chernihiv.
Chernihiv, it's like, I think, another story. It's Polisia, yeah, it's like forest, and maybe it was just easier to find some food in forest for peasants, just in terms of food, I would say.
Yeah, and
no wheat. But sure. Please.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that, again, it looks like the dynamic is different. With Chernihiv, it's forested areas where there was less in terms of collectivization efforts to get grain, and forest provided means for survival. In the western borderland with Poland, I guess you are the author of the border hypothesis that we are discussing here. But look at Kharkiv; that's the border with Russia,
right.
Where there is no police and the forest type of a situation, and there is no kind of a no difference between the immediate border areas and areas closer to the center.
Actually, it's a question what happened, like what we will see after the border of Ukraine, I mean in neighboring rayons of Russian Federation. Unfortunately, we don't find, I tried, but unfortunately I haven't found information by rayon for Kursk, Belgorod and Voronezh Oblast, only for central Black Earth Oblast, like total, but not by rayon. Unfortunately, in Moscow. I assume this data exists. Actually, Witkroft has it, but we don't have
it. Just one more question. So you have differences of 100, which is still like fairly significant in your rayon maps. Is it possible to zoom in even further, like a difference between from 1 to 50, from 50 to 100?
Yeah, of course.
It's possible to
zoom. We have data like by rayon, for each
right.
rayon. Yeah.
On the maps, it's possible to zoom in this
yes.
much?
You can go in the interactive atlas.
Interactive.
I've shown you some of those filters.
Mm-hmm.
So when you put a number in the filter, it will filter out the results that you're looking for.
Okay.
So go back to filters, and I can show you how to do that.
I'm just following up on Andre. If you did that to the Pogron Polisa, would you find that the pattern that as you get closer to the border, within that 1 to 100, it goes down? That is, the rayon that are directly bordering Poland are lower than the rayoni that are in one. That would be interesting to see.
Mm-hmm.
That would be my suspicion.
It was according to Wieskroft.
It is.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Other questions? More comments, maybe? Yes, a little bit.
If there are no other questions, I have a couple of methodological questions. One is, in your analyses that you presented, and I find them, very thorough and very convincing, very persuasive. Do you simply rely on your own interpretation of the demographic data, or have you also considered the various analyses of other scholars? Wheatcroft was mentioned, for example. There's also Mr. Tauger, who has done weather correlations and that sort of thing. Do you have you taken those into account? And following from that, I wonder whether, paying due respect to your analyses, whether giving the statistical data and the results that you have produced to scholars who do not deal with statistics, but may have, for example, experience in dealing with cadre politics regionally, or certain economic indices connected with industrialization, that might be helpful in bringing scholars with different types of expertise together. Have you been including such?
Definitely,
specialists?
I would include, so I just would appreciate such help and discussion. I think that in general, Holodomor, like the truth about the Holodomor is so complicated that like demographer just provides some basement, for estimate, but explanation of this for this difference should come from like collaborative work. So
exactly.
We definitely need to demographer definitely need to collaborate as much as possible, first of all with historians, but also with economists and other disciplines. Definitely yes. Yeah. And as to your first question, to my knowledge, Witkroft's estimates is based on register statistics, so he didn't seek like to provide any estimates of losses. As I already explained, losses, it's, no, I already explained, provide the definition. for losses, yeah? So he just analyzed mortality, registered deaths, yeah? But I don't remember if he tried. Actually, his main assumption and hypothesis about high level of mortality, registered mortality even, so in Kyiv and Kharkiv, is because there are two like large cities in this oblast, the capital of Kharkiv that time, yeah, and Kyiv. So he stated that just because authorities like must feed local population, like of population of the city, they imposed like higher quotas for local peasants in within this oblast. So this is his like main assumption. Yeah, I don't think so actually, but I'm not sure who was responsible for distribution of quotas, whether like Kyiv or Moscow. I don't know yet if somebody can help me with such documents just to prove or disprove this Pitcroft assumption.
If I can jump in and then with the as far as I remember, even from the documents in the Perih volume, the oblast level was decided in Moscow.
Yes, oblast level, at least approved. Yes.
But certainly raion, my understanding that was the local responsibility of the local officials. And that would mean probably that Whitcroft's hypothesis has some problems if again the overall figure for Kyiv was produced in Moscow and not by the locals. That puts of course his argument in jeopardy, I would say. Roman, please.
Thank you for a very interesting talk. Just to follow up, can we explain Odessa by the presence of a strong party man there in terms of the quotas all up there? But my real question is, does it make any sense to add urban data to these calculations? Will they change the patterns in any significant way? One of my concerns is that, I don't know to what extent, but a lot of rural people entered the urban area and died. So I'm not sure how that affects the count. So I was wondering whether you looked at that or if the urban data actually is not important in these assumptions.
Actually, we estimated excess deaths by urban and rural areas, so we have such data. I actually haven't presented it because I think that it's like another topic. And it turned out that not much, but still almost 4% of urban population of Ukraine died from the famine, or perished due to the famine. So 4%, it's about 300,000 of urban residents. It's still high amount, like still high figure, yeah. And we have such data. I think this map is available on that MAPA website. You can easily find it. But as I said, the dynamics of urban losses is very different from rural losses. Why? Because, you know, 90% of total excess deaths occurred in rural areas. We know that, yeah? And like complex interaction between different factors, procurement, collectivization, grain requisition, and so on. But in urban areas, it's more about system of food rationing, yeah? So, which was implemented, as I remember, in 1929. And this system was very different, like it differed by cities. It depends like Kyiv or Kharkiv, Kryvyi Rih or Zaporizhia. So Stalin distributed rations according to the value, I would say, of this city. according to the value of industry, which were like prevailed in this city. That was the main criteria for food rationing system. So this system is the main factor in explaining of distribution of urban losses, I would say.
Thank you. Well,
it's very, very, very impressive work. Congratulations. It's a real addition. I was just wondering about a few factors, partly just to put them on your plate. I'm not sure whether they're ones that one can or can't do. The one was the one Andre talked about, the book run policy. The other one was, you know, the data on mass disturbances from the, you know, that the NKVD collects. They had a certain amount of systematicity to it, and I mean, I've seen them done by a, you know, oblast in the you know, the Danilov volumes, when they, you know, they record murders, mass disturbances. What else is there? They've got about 5 or 6, but they had a whole nomenclature of it. If those were preserved, it might be interesting to look at the correlation between mass disturbances and.
Yeah, I think so. But how to collect, how to find this data? Actually, it's like. It's maybe the most important, but at the same time, the most difficult task.
Oh, have you tried?
Not yet.
Yeah.
Just like look through some books and some collection of documents, but of course it's not yet finished.
Yeah.
Kate Brown has
it's
argued that mass disturbances correlate with lower collectivization, right? Because they made it hard to collectivize in places.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes.
So then that way it would have impacted.
We are in the process of talking with the SBO archive on the project specifically dealing with the disturbances, and one of the challenges that is there that the GPU or whatever was the name back then, not very systematic. So on the oblast level, yes, you can follow that and you can follow over the period of years, but on the raion level sometimes some raions exist, others don't. And for us, important thing was to find the kind of statistics and the forms that we can follow, starting before the famine and hopefully following into 1934 and 35. So we are still in the middle of the talks, but we are looking to find out, okay, whether there is anything or not that we can compare over the period of time and then map.
That's great. The other much I think easier thing to do that would just be sort of interesting as a side thing would be looking at where the central figures that are sent down, so Molotov and Kaganovich, where they go and whether there's any impact on that. Molotov goes to Petrovsk, so
there is a book about
it. Petrovsk goes, and does Kaganovich go to?
No, Kaganovich North Caucasus.
He goes to Luban, but in the previous year, he's sent it. I mean, they both go down several times, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Anyway, that would be interesting to see what they, like, it seems that they get sent to the regions where there's less famine. Like, they're not sent to, if I'm remembering.
I have to check.
Yeah.
Which would make sense. They're pumping out grain.
Yeah.
And the main grain producing areas are in the south.
But they're also preserving those areas because they're worried about grain harvests in the coming years, so they don't take too much.
Again, it's a big question. One thing that it's more or less clear is that in those areas they're sending, they're given so-called loans, and they're sending so-called assistance.
Right.
So that goes to the south, and this is again another big question, given that the south getting more help and direct help from Moscow, Kiev has to argue to get assistance for the center.
Yeah.
That certainly affects the figures.
Yeah.
So, and again, the policies related to the quote unquote assistance, that's a different chapter.
Yeah, that was going to be my last.
Yeah, so many these chapters.
Yes, please. Yes.
My background is more from Asia and living in regions that have had food shortages and sort of seeing what happens. But I observe, as you've noticed, that at the individual level, and this is not usually captured in statistics, the first thing people start doing is using their knowledge of edible plants in the countryside or wasteland to start supplementing their diet with things that can be gathered. So looking at the ecology of these regions and the carrying capacity of the forest for people, you know, finding food in it might be interesting, especially if you talk to people who actually have experience of other famines, you know, more recently, who can maybe tell you something about it's not necessarily the same with the behavior of people, but to use the forest, you need time and you need knowledge of what to do. So if you don't have that, or the social conditions are such that you're prevented from doing that, then maybe you can exacerbate the problem. Those are very, very high loss rates in some of the more severely affected rayons.
Yeah, it's another hypothesis about explaining this regional distribution of the losses, ecological hypothesis, that probably can explain why Chernihiv suffered much less than, for instance, Kharkiv. I mean, ecological hypothesis probably might explain why Chernihiv Oblast suffered much less than, for instance, central part of Kyiv or Kharkiv Oblast, because people can easily search for some food in forest. It's one of the hypotheses, I would say.
What they worried about in Canada, where I'm from during the 50s, some people I talked to, was if there were ever a need to evacuate the cities for whatever reason, though the forest had capacity to support populations for a year or two, people wouldn't know what to do. So the malnutrition effects and subsequent disease effects would be far more severe.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not, anyway, it's worth looking at.
Thank you.
I know that your team has been looking at the regions of the Russian Federation, which I think is a very important undertaking. You mentioned that, unfortunately, you have not been able to do the kind of regional or micro-regional analysis there as you have in Ukraine. Is that because the data, such data for the Russian Federation one does not exist, or it does exist but it's not available, or three, it is available but you have not yet done it? In other words, is there the prospect that such analysis will still be done?
I hope so. We managed to find, as I already mentioned, data for Russia by large regions, and we estimated the famine losses for 17 large regions of Russia, and we also, and three like sub-regions within these two of these large regions. So total 20 regions, total 20 regions of Russia. But unfortunately, as I already said, we haven't found data by raion for the Black Earth Central Oblast, which is like kind of interest for us because it's like neighboring oblast to Ukraine. We also haven't found data by raion for instance, Krasnodar Krai, because we also interested in Kuban region, but we don't have such data. But as I said, it is very likely that Whitcroft has such data because he published some map, but we don't have, unfortunately. And I don't know, we were searching and we're looking for in Russian state archives in Moscow several times, but we haven't found it. And it's about Russia. It's very interesting. Let me show you again this map. Oh, maybe it's here. As I said, the highest losses are found in Volga German Autonomous Republic, Saratov Oblast, and Krasnodar Krai. That are the main grain-producing areas, raions, or regions of the Russian Federation compared to Ukraine. And I assume that it's like still a lot of work to explain this difference, especially about Volga German Autonomous Republic, I would say. Because this data, unfortunately, again, in collection of document archives, so like not enough information about Volga German, usually only about Lower Volga Krai, but not specifically about Volga German.
Yes, please.
What is the role, do you think, of shtetls, like somewhere between rural and urban small towns, you know, both as affecting the surrounding countryside survival and, I guess, affecting the overall statistics through their own survival?
Actually, we haven't, like, explored especially this part of movement, but I think, yes, it could affect.
Do we have data on the urban losses?
Yes,
and shtetl would be there.
It's just Vinnytsia usually.
Right,
yeah,
right.
Shtetl,
so
Vinnytsia
you can
region,
get
yeah.
some idea by mapping the urban losses. But again, the shtetl specifically is.
It's Vinnytsia and Kyiv, I think.
It, it,
yeah?
is
it refers
and
only
Kyiv.
To these two regions, not to the like total.
So, if I remember correctly, the pattern is more or less the same, where you see the heaviest rural losses, that where the urban losses would be high as well, and we are talking about small towns where shtetl would be part of that. So. Am I right in terms of
yes.
the way how I remember yes. that? So that's, and the map is available now on the website, on our website. The urban losses for. You know, for
Nataliia, on the German issue, you've presumably mapped the German raioni.
Yes, we estimated losses.
How did they compare to neighboring raioni? Higher,
lower, same? No, it's definitely it's higher. It's higher. No, it's comparable
to the German raioni
do you mean for Ukraine? Not
yes,
for,
exactly.
Sorry.
To see whether the German ethnicity is an issue or not.
This kind of research has been done recently by my colleague Oleg Volovina, so it's maybe better for him to present his results. But we estimated losses by nationalities. Five main ethnic groups plus like group of the rest of nationalities. So it turned out like the higher losses are found for Ukrainians, which are at least two times higher than any other nationality. Then the second Polish, third Russian, fourth German, and five Jewish. So if you rank by numbers, yeah.
Is that adjusted then for where they were located?
No, it's total and by region. Not just by specific, like national, like German region, but it's total for Ukraine and also by region, for eight regions presented here.
And you get the same lineup by region?
Yeah. And actually, this map is available.
You can look it up. It's, we have it.
This map is already available. Kostya downloaded it yesterday to the website.
Yeah, the interactive atlas has twice as many maps, so you can look. We have that already. We have them mapped all together over the regions.
Yes, Terry, and then Lubomir, or the other way around. Okay, Lubomir. Yeah.
Very quickly, on your map that includes Russia, I didn't notice whether you had any particular data on Crimea, which of course was at that time in the Russian Federation. You mentioned the Voronezh, Kursk, Belgorod.
We have Crimea.
But what about Crimea?
Because it was like, you know, autonomous republic, so like separate union, yeah. And we have. Yes. Here, Crimea is 23 per 1,000 of rural population. So it's very low level compared to the rest of Ukraine's countries. Yeah. And very low compared to Krasnodar Krai as well.
Now, in the colors on the map, they don't seem to fit the numbers in the colors don't seem to fit.
Those are absolute numbers, actually.
Numbers are absolute.
The
colors not relative.
Are relative, yes.
Yeah,
and the bars are also different. You see, you can read it in the legend.
Mm-hmm. There's no raion data for the Russian parts, is there?
No. Only large regions. As you see here, you can see borders. Yeah, boundaries.
But in Volga, ISSR, it seems to me we have raions, yeah? Or not really?
No.
No.
No. I actually found some data for Volga German by cantons, like by raion, but specifically for this territory, not for the lower, like for total lower Volga. And it turned out very interesting. I just like looked briefly at register statistics. Yeah, and it turned out that in Volga German, like at that time there were, I think, 12 cantons, 12 raions. Nine of them were German, and four Russian. So only one of four Russian raions had so high level of mortality compared to German cantons. So it's very visible just briefly looking at the official registered data, I would say. So it's another issue.
And what about Belarusia, appropriately whited out here? Is there any information on what happened there?
Yes, we estimated losses like for 11 Soviet republics, including Belarus. I don't remember exactly the number for Belarus, but I remember that this figure is really low. Yeah. And as far like as I know, only south of Belarusia, like a few of raions, southern raions, suffered from the famine at that time.
And did the Kostya mention the railway distance? Did you explore that hypothesis?
Yes, I included this variable into my analysis, and the effect was negligible.
Nataliia was really very big on the transportation system and spent enormous amount of time trying to make sense.
It's a plausible hypothesis.
But it didn't work. Okay, so I guess unless there are other questions, I am ready to declare now a seminar series really now complete and over. And I want to thank again Nataliia and Kostyantyn, and say something that is related to what we discussed here. In the last maybe 5 or 6 years, the demographers and by extension cartographers are really in the driving seat when it comes to any change that is happening in the study, or real change that is happening in the study of the famine. And they're really setting the agenda, because you look at these maps and that produces enormous amount of questions. Demographers can't answer them on their own, and that's really where cooperation, historians and others, is really necessary. But again, you now know what you're looking for. You have these puzzles that are out there, and you try to understand them. And again, in my previous work on that, it actually worked. So the puzzles were real, they were not misleading, and you really, it's much easier to work with this enormous data when you know what the question is. And so again, I want to thank both of you for this really pioneering work. Thank you. Thanks, and We were under the impression that no one will show up today. it's already May, but it looks like we are hungry for knowledge, especially not for fake news, but for real ones. Okay, thank you.
Я бачите, я не сказала за цю food assistant, бо в мене нема даних по районів, але її треба було згадати, бо це дуже важливо саме для 2023 року, до того скачка в першому. Але якби ми знайшли такі дані по районам, то
дійсно, це адженда для того, щоб які шукати далі питання, як розподілялося, ким розподілялося, що бралося до уваги. І велике питання дійсно, що сталося в Бондарєнку.
Чи це випадково вийшло, чи ні, не знаю. А що ви скажете про погоду?
Погоду, я не знаю, чи вам Роман показує, він карти привіз.
Ні, я його ще не бачила.
Він виходить. Тобто не виходить в розумінні, що немає ніякого такого паттерну і так далі, те, що я бачив ваше також. Значить, ну єдине, що я думаю, що там погода ні до чого, але інколи досить якийсь скачок, якийсь заморозок.
Та ви знаєте, що корелює з втратами? Корелює. Я пробувала купу з собою, воно корелює з втратами. Але я хочу сказати, що статистичний аналіз буде тільки тоді правильний, якщо ми включаємо інші всі фактори. Тобто, якщо включити всі інші і контролювати пропозицію.
Там карта, що приніс Роман, там цікаво показує відхилення в східній частині, фактично в Харківській області, але в Київській. Там
ну, дивлячись, яка дата, там було кілька.
Так, так, що там буде відхилення?
It's really interesting mentality. Yeah, really, really good work. I think it's really at the cutting edge of what's being done scientifically. On the famine and the fact that you're trying to get the Russian data. Is Wheatcroft not helping? Yes. He's not. Yeah.
Well, he's apparently you are writing to him, and he's just Volovina was writing, so it's really
different. It seems that he doesn't want to share this data.
Where is the link to the filter on the drink with him?
He's not like. He's not like a bad sort by nature.
I never kind of probably met him, but I should
do that. Let's do a joint. Russian-Ukrainian thing, I'll put that back to my hotel. Next time that he's in North America.
Again, if you hear that he is somewhere in the area.
Yeah, if he's in North America.
He's not retired anymore. Because I'm a little bit terrified just bringing someone and paying for the...